House Environment Natural Resources Policy and Finance Committee to order. We have a quorum. Representative Uglum, could you move the minutes from yesterday, March 15th?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I certainly will.
Discussion to the minutes. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, nay. The minutes are adopted. Welcome, Mr. Johnson. Once you go ahead, I think it would be appropriate maybe take 10, 15 minutes. I'm going to move House File 2611 to be passed and sent on to the Legacy Committee. Do we have an appropriate name for to the Legacy Funding Finance Committee? And welcome, if you could identify yourself for the record and begin to take 10, 15 minutes to walk through the bill, that would work good, and then we'll begin. Thank you.
Morning, Mr. Chair. Thank you. Mark Johnson, Executive Director for the Lasard Sams Outdoor Heritage Council. Mr. Chair, with the bill is a bill summary overview. Can you hear me okay?
We'll get the volume turned up. Go ahead.
Very good.
You're fine.
With the bill is a recommendation summary or an overview, which I'll give you. We'll give you a high-level view of the bill. That's better? Good. Thank you. And so basically, this is, again, for fiscal year 2017, the Outdoor Heritage Recommendations from the Lasard Sams Outdoor Heritage Council. It's the eighth year of funding with 40 proposals totaling about $115 million. One thing for sure that you should know is that within this overview, there is an omission on purpose, and we have omitted the Conservation Partner Legacy Grant Program, which is about a $9.4 million appropriation within the recommendations. The reason is that's a smaller grants program, and we really don't know what the outcomes will be of that until that is let later by DNR. But that said, the bill in itself, from an overview standpoint, the majority
Mr. Johnson,
of activity.
Just, excuse me. Sorry. Thank you. If there's anybody in the audience that still can't hear him, would you raise your hand? I'm thinking we're okay. Yep, we're okay. Go ahead.
Great. In the bill as a whole, the majority of activity is 79% for enhancement and restoration from an acreage standpoint, and 76% of the funding actually goes to acquisition, with that acquisition being 43% in fee acquisition and 33% for easement acquisition. At an overview standpoint, again, the PILT obligation is about $171,000 within this package. And let's see. Within the overview also, you have several schematics that will show you how that lays out from a biome standpoint or from an activity and a funding standpoint across the state. Statewide, I should also mention one more thing. From a standpoint of activity within the metro area, from a percentage standpoint of activity, there's only 3% of the activity that happens within the metro, but that is 7% of the funding. Now, again, that does not include the Conservation Partner Legacy Program, which would be another $2.5 million into the metro area. So we're looking at about a 9.5% right now, or 9%. Of the activity, or of the funding, I'm sorry, for the metro areas. And on the back of the summary is the list of the projects that are in the bill. With that overview, Mr. Chair, I'll go right into the bill.
Go ahead.
All right.
Excuse me, Representative Hansen.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and Mr. Johnson. I appreciate the percentage on discussion on the percentage in the metro area. How does that compare to previous years? It seems like every year it's a single digit percentage when the metro area is more than 10% of the population or the sales. I just wonder what the response would be if the reverse were true.
Director Johnson.
Mr. Chair and Representative Hansen, this is a little bit lower than it has been in the past, to my knowledge. There may be other activities that take place, but this is all of the information within this as far as from a, let's back up. From a funding standpoint, you're correct. It's slightly less, I believe, than it has been in the past, than it was last year. Part of that is, I don't know why, to tell you the truth. I think DNR primarily has been looking at what were the requests for funding that they got through the CPL. And that was with the Metro especially, and they figured that 2.5 would meet that demand. Most recently, as I understand, DNR has had an uptick in that in their very recent requests from Metro recipients. So that's a good sign.
Representative Hansen.
Mr. Chair, Mr. Johnson, I think I've heard anecdotally that with the CPL program, there are groups that aren't even applying anymore because they won't, because of the interpretation that any purchase or any activity must be on land that is open for hunting. And that in the metro area, there may be angling opportunities, stream bank restoration, et cetera, that would qualify. I think it stems back to a continuing misinterpretation of the Constitution that says that as provided by law, not that everything has to be. So when there is an interpretation that every acquisition or activity must be on land that can be both have angling and hunting, then that screens out any metro project, and that could be in Rochester, or Duluth, or St. Cloud, or Moorhead, Mankato as well. So I know that the council had discussed that with the RFP, but I think it was referenced that council members were hearing that as well.
Director Johnson.
Mr. Chair, Representative Hansen. Yes, at the last council meeting on the 11th of March, the council actually did speak about that. And because of time, we moved it forward to the the June 29th meeting of the council. DNR has been asking us to, or had asked us at this meeting to give them some time on the next agenda to discuss that issue. And I think what we're going to find is there will be a lack of ambiguities going forward. There's going to be a coming together, and I think it'll be a little more acceptable.
Thank you. Director Johnson, why don't you walk through the bill? I think it would be good if each subdivision you could note, for instance, I think the first one would be Prairies, $31,657,000, and then just note the projects it includes. And it probably makes sense to also state that dollar amount, but you're basically going to read this sheet, so I want members to know it's the color handout to the very back of that. Mr. Johnson, Director Johnson, will walk through and just mention that, and I think that would make sense. Representative Hansen, is that fine? We will have you do that so that we can, and it'll be on the tape then. But why don't you mention the subdivision total, project name, dollar amount, and then we can follow through in the bill or on the back of the sheet, and then we'll move through the substance of the meeting. Thank you, Director. Go ahead.
Mr. Chair, the arrangement, the order in the bill may be slightly different on one or two as compared to the back of the sheet.
Okay, Director Johnson, why don't you do it? You want to do it through the bill might make the most sense. So follow in the bill, and they're going to be responsible for themselves to find the differences. You don't need to note that. Go ahead.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Yes, subdivision two in the bill is the Prairies section. This is 11 different projects for a total of $31,657,000. The first project is 2A, which is the DNR Wildlife Management Area and Scientific Natural Areas Acquisition Phase 8. It's for $3.25 million. The second project in the bill is 2B, the Accelerating Wildlife Management Area Acquisition Phase 8 for $5.229 million, and that's a project with Pheasants Forever in the lead. The 2C is the Martin County Fox Lake Wildlife Management Area Acquisition for $1 million. This is with the Fox Lake Conservation. It's an acquisition project. Fox Lake Conservation League, I'm sorry. 2D is the Northern Tallgrass Prairies National Wildlife Refuge Land Acquisition Phase 7 for $3.411 million. And this is Nature Conservancy in the lead in cooperation with U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service.
Director Johnson, just read the first, first half of the title is fine, Northern Tallgrass Prairie and the dollar amount. Then we'll be able to follow the rest. Thank you.
Very good, sir. 2E is the Cannon River Habitat or Headwaters Habitat for $583,000. F is the Accelerated Native Prairie Bank Protection for $2.541 million. 2G is the Reinvest in Minnesota RIM Buffers for Wildlife and Water for $6.708 million. 2H is the Prairie Chicken Habitat Partnership for Southern Red River Valley for $2.269 million. 2I is the Grassland Conservation Partnership Phase 2 for $1.475 million. 2J is the Accelerated Prairie Restoration and Enhancement on DNR Lands Phase 8 for $3.983 million. 2K is the Anoka Sand Plains Habitat Restoration and Enhancement for $1.208 million. That's a Phase 4 project. The Subdivision 3 is now where we're going to. It's the forest section. And the first, it's 10 different projects. The first is Young Forest Conservation Phase 2 for $3.69 million. The second is 3B, which is Jack Pine Forest, Crow Wing River Watershed Habitat Acquisition for $5.532 million. 3C is the Camp Ripley Partnership for $1.5 million. 3D is the Southeast Minnesota Protection and Restoration for $5 million. 3E is the Minnesota Forest for the Future Phase 4 for $1.84 million. 3F is the Protect Key Forest Lands in Cass County for $500,000. The State Forest Acquisitions is next, is 3G for $1 million. 3H is the Forest Habitat Protection Revolving Account for $1 million. And 3I is a Mississippi River Floodplain Forest Enhancement for $412,000. 3J is protecting forest habitat, forest wildlife habitat in the Wild Rice River for $2.188 million. And now we're into Subdivision 4, which is the wetlands portion. There are six projects here. The first of which is accelerating the waterfall production area acquisitions for $6.307 million. The second is 4B, actually, the Shallow Lake and Wetland Protection Program. 4C is the RIM Wetland Partnership for $13.808 million. 4D is the Wetland Habitat Protection Program for $1.629 million. 4E is Accelerated Shallow Lakes and Wetland Enhancement for $2.167 million. 4F is Marsh Lake Phase 2, which is a $2 million project. And that brings us to Subdivision 5, the Habitats portion, which is 11 projects within that for a total of $31,769,000 in this area. 5A is the DNR Aquatic Habitat Protection for $1.578 million. 5B is the Metro Big Rivers Habitat for $4 million. 5C is the Mississippi Headwaters Habitat Corridor Partnership for $3.15 million. 5D is the Fisheries Habitat Protection on Strategic North Central Minnesota Lakes for $1.425 million. 5E is the Minnesota Trout Unlimited Cold Water Fish Habitat Enhancement and Restoration for $2.632 million. 5F is a DNR stream habitat for $2.074 million. 5G is the St. Louis River Restoration Initiative for $2.707 million. 5H is the Sandhill River Fish Passage, and this is for $828,000. 5I is the Shell Rock River Watershed Habitat Restoration Program for $1.2 million. 5J is the Roseau Lake Rehabilitation for $2.763 million. And 5K, the last in this area, is the Conservation Partners Legacy Grant Program statewide and metro for $9.412 million. Mr. Chair, would you like me to continue through the other subdivisions?
You know, Director Johnson, please do mention the last two, what the amount is, and maybe just a second about the management and what that is, so we know that's included too. Thank you.
The Mr. Chair, again, the last two you're stating the could you repeat that, please?
I thought, don't you have both the contract management and technical evaluation panel? If you could touch on those.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Chair. Subdivision 6 is Administration, and that is, there's a $275,000 total on this appropriation. There are two segments. The first is contract management for $150,000 to the DNR, and the second is technical evaluation panel for $125,000, and that is for restoration and enhancement evaluations. And then, of course, Subdivision 7 goes into appropriations availability. Subdivision 8 is the payment conditions and capital enhancement expenditure or capital equipment expenditures. Subdivision 9 is mapping. And then we get into Subdivision 10, which is a actual amendment to clarify some previous language and previous law.
Thank you. And Director Johnson, the reason you didn't mention the administration, that was funded last year for the biennial.
Correct,
yeah,
sir.
Thank you. Members, we're going to move into amendments at this time. And the first one is my amendment. It's the A23. That amendment takes the recommendations that the Lasard Sams Outdoor Heritage Council made at its meeting last Friday with the budget surplus being at $900 million now, that put the recommendations of Lasard Sams in the red. And so their recommendation was to go to approximately a 3% cushion. And so, members, I would move. Director Johnson, why don't you touch on the four projects that were adjusted. Why don't you just mention which ones they are? And they're back to the original recommendations from Lasard Sams in their November meeting. We're going back to where it was when we were using the February forecast before the November forecast came. Why don't you just say which those four projects are? You don't need to say the dollar amounts. They're listed.
Sure, Mr. Chair, thank you. The first one, Mr. Chair, is the Northern Tallgrass Prairie National Wildlife Refuge land acquisition. The second was, pardon me if I may, the accelerating the waterfowl production areas acquisition. Each of those are being reduced by $657,000. The third is the Minnesota Trout Unlimited cold water fish habitat enhancement and restoration, reduced by the same. And the third was the Conservation Partners Legacy Program, reduced by $1.974 million.
And Director Johnson includes a typo on page 15, line 29.
That's correct.
Was a technical adjustment. Discussion to the A23 amendment. Representative Hansen.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And Mr. Johnson, do you know what's left on the bottom line in terms of percentage after we make the cuts?
With this change, sir,
Director Johnson.
Mr. Chair and Representative Hansen, with this change, approximately 3.2%.
And Mr. Hagemeyer, and the dollar amount for that, what is what's the dollar in millions?
Mr. Chair, yep. The dollar amount left on the bottom line with this amendment would be $3,328,000, which is a 3.21% reserve.
Representative Hansen.
And Mr. Chair, and maybe Mr. Hagemeyer or Mr. Johnson would know this, if there were potential cancellations at the end of the year, those would go then to the bottom line. If it's, say, a four-year-old project that doesn't get done, then that would go to the bottom line.
Mr. Hagemeyer.
Mr. Chair, that is correct. If there are cancellations on June 30th or a different date, those would fall to the bottom line.
Representative Hansen.
And thank you, Mr. Chair, and Mr. Johnson and Mr. Hagemeyer. I think it's good that we leave some on the bottom line. It's my understanding, Mr. Hagemeyer, that two of the other funds did not leave much on the bottom line and have a bigger problem, that the arts and the water didn't leave a percent. Is that correct?
Mr. Hagemeyer.
Mr. Chair, that's correct. Two of the other funds are projected negative at this time as well. The Parks and Trails is slightly positive. Clean Water Fund is a little bit more negative than this, and those have been appropriated already. And the Arts and Cultural Heritage is more negative, and that's a smaller pot of money as well.
Representative Hanson.
So, Mr. Chair, I think it's good management to leave a little bit on uncertain times with this. So.
And thank you for that comment, Representative Hanson. And for members' information, MMB recommends somewhere between 5 and 10%. Lessard-Sams has moved into the positive, but they're still well below the recommended level from MMB. This is to get them to 3%. Further discussion on the A23, seeing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, nay. The amendment, the A23 is adopted. Representative Green, I have your amendment next. Representative Green, you want to move the A4 amendment. This is the amendment that deals with the Office of the Legislative Auditor. Maybe Representative Green, why don't you tell us the effect of your amendment?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I'd like to move this amendment. This in last year, we did pass within the Legacy Fund an amendment on that that would prevent anyone from getting funds if they're not in compliance with the law, according to the Legislative Auditor's report. What this amendment simply does is says that we're going to withhold these funds until the Legislative Auditor's report comes out for 2016. I have talked to them, and I don't think it's going to be that long before it's out. I couldn't get an exact date. But when the Legislative Auditor signs off and says that these agencies and entities are in compliance with the law, then they can receive the funds, but not until.
Thank you, Representative Green. And to remind members, this fund is required to be audited periodically by the OLA. It was in the original bill, and that continues to be the case. Discussions to the A4. Representative Hanson.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And Representative Green, I have just a couple questions on which specific things you're asking for. So, Mr. Chair, is it it's the financial audit that's annually done or that's routinely done, not a program evaluation?
It isn't. I think, Mr. Chair and Representative Hanson, I believe in this case, it is the audit that is scheduled to be coming up. You know, when I talked to them and I asked them when this audit would be done, and they gave me a vague date, but it was sometime in the spring, hopefully. So it is the regular audit. So if you're asking me, is this a special audit? I don't believe so.
Correct. My understanding is this is a program audit that's done every year. Representative Hanson.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And I'm, you know, I'd like to check with Mr. Nobles just on this, but I'm willing to, you know, if there's something that's impossible, maybe we can deal with that later. But it seems it's the routine audit, and I think we want to make sure that everything's okay.
I think that's a good idea, Representative Hanson. It is a good government point that if you're messed up and the auditor says your house isn't in order, we should not be giving them more money. That's Representative Green's intent, and that's a good idea, and it is clarifying what you did last year. It's clarifying that, and if the auditor tells us it's problematic and can't work, then we'll deal with that. But the intent is, let's not give money to somebody who's upside down and doesn't have their thing together. Seeing no further discussion, all in favor of the A4, say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, nay. The amendment's adopted. The next amendment is the A14 amendment. I believe that's your amendment, Representative Fabian. Representative, is that correct? Representative Fabian moves the A14. Representative Fabian.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. This amendment is the result of conversation that I had with the Kitson County Board of Commissioners. One of the NGOs, the Nature Conservancy, acquired some land with the Lessard-Sams funding, and then at some point in the future they deeded that over. I don't know the technical term for that, but then it went over to U.S. Fish and Wildlife. There was very little conversation with the Kitson County Board of Commissioners. They came to me and said, in the future, we would like to have say and basic approval. So what my amendment does is it requires the NGOs to get local county commission approval before they could do a transfer to somebody else.
Any discussion on the A14? Representative Hanson.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And I was wondering if DNR could just testify on their process and what this would mean when there's transfer from an NGO to the DNR, like a little more explanation on process.
Why doesn't the DNR come forward and tell us how they do it and the requirement in law that they consult with the local county boards? And then is there anyone in the audience that wanted to speak to this specific amendment? Anyone in the audience that wanted to speak to this amendment? Okay. PNR, if you want to identify yourself for the record and give us your, did you hear Representative Hansen's questions? Go ahead.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and members of the committee. Grant Wilson, Minnesota Department of Natural Resources. So just briefly, the department has some statutory requirements on county board approval, specifically for purchase of wildlife management areas, wildlife management area easements, scientific and natural areas, and then any lands purchased with RIM funds, and any additional lands that are purchased requires a notification, but not approval. So we follow those procedures, and they're actually outlaid in an internal operation order that lays out procedures on acquisition for the department.
Representative Hansen,
thank you, Mr. Chair, and maybe following up or going down the road a little bit here. So if an NGO goes and purchases and then transfer, do you see any challenges if an NGO buys with this procedure, what this procedure would do for an NGO buying and then transferring to the DNR be part of your system?
Mr. Wilson.
Mr. Chair, I think we'd have to consider that with our internal lands and minerals. I'm not an expert in how the mechanics of that would work, so I think we would have to discuss with them how that might play out.
Representative Hansen.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and maybe to be clear, does the DNR support this amendment?
Mr. Wilson.
Mr. Chair, I think we're not going to speak to that. I think we think we have a pretty robust means in communicating with county boards, in notifying them of what's happening with our projects. We aim to have local support. Obviously, that's very important to what we do, and so we always want to have good, robust discussions with our partners, NGOs as well, as they're doing land acquisitions and making donations.
And Mr. Wilson, I want to remind members that in current LCCMR policy, if the land's being bought by an NGO with LCCMR dollars, they are required to get the county board approval. So Representative Fabian is aligning Lassard Sam similar to LCCMR guidelines in regards to DNR-owned land. Representative Fabian, I believe your amendment also applies to U.S. Fish and Wildlife land, but that policy is in place that NGOs can't skirt the intent of the law in LCCMR, and we're trying to align these to the same. Further discussion to the A4, Representative Hansen. I'm sorry, it's the A14. Did I move the wrong amendment? Representative Fabian, did I move the A14?
Mr. Chair, I'm quite sure that you said A14.
Okay. I thought you were moving one of mine.
Oh, no. Representative Hansen to the A14.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. That's all I have for DNR, unless Representative Eklund, did you have one for DNR? A question? When I look through the bill, there's a lot of money going to Pheasants Forever, Nature Conservancy, Ducks Unlimited. I guess I'd like to know from them what their input is on this amendment.
Do any of the interest groups want to speak to the amendment? It doesn't look like it. Representative Fabian renews his motion for the A14 amendment be adopted. All those in favor say aye.
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 Opposed, nay. The amendment's adopted. Representative Neuberger, is your the A24 is the next one. Is that your amendment?
Yes, sir, Mr. Chair.
Representative Neuberger moves the A24 amendment. Representative Neuberger, could you explain the amendment?
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and members. This simply inserts the language after lands on page 7, line 11, to excluding state forests. This is at this point in the game, this is a necessary move that we take until we can resolve some very deep-seated ongoing issues that are taking place within the state forest lands. In particular, the sand dune state forest, which is in my district. Picture, if you will, a beautiful mature pine forest. It's been there for decades. It's absolutely gorgeous. And we have private homes that are interspersed throughout this land. on private property. It's kind of a jigsaw puzzle if you look at it on a map, but it's a beautiful place to live. It's part of what makes Minnesota so wonderful. A short while back, a few years back, the DNR decided they were going to come in and clear-cut vast sections of this and so that they could replant it with oaks. They want to restore it to what they call as oak savanna. I don't know about you, but if you've ever seen clear-cutting, it looks like a barbarian horde goes through when they're done. I understand the DNR's intent here, what they're trying to do, but there's some serious questions that have come up in regards to this, and I don't think it's the best decision at this time. I could go into a number of details as to why, just out of respect for time, I will just leave it at that. So that's my motion, Mr. Chair.
Well, thank you, Representative Neuberger. Representative Hansen, I know Assistant Commissioner Meyer was here and walked out. I'm wondering if you want to ask your question, and then maybe Mr. Wilson can see if he would come back available, because I would like to probably allow them to specifically talk about your concerns, Representative Neuberger. Representative Hansen.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chair. I was just commenting, it seems like St. Patrick's Day came a little early, because Representative Neuberger seems to be a little green this morning. It's kind of he's got a smile on his face, feeling a little green.
Well, Representative Hansen, I think Representative Neuberger makes a great point about what's going on there. And maybe, Representative Neuberger, there's a time and a place for when land that in some cases was actually paid for, if I remember right, by bonding money. This forest reforestation or periodic planting of trees on DNR land was done with bonding money. Does it make more sense to at least wait for the natural progression and for the cycle to work its way through? Now, I realize in some cases pines, that could be 100 years, but and then if it makes sense when the final cut is made, whether it be a clear cut or a periodic removal, then should we consider, does it make sense to change that? Commissioner Meyer, I think if you could weigh in on the DNR policy to, clear-cut land before it's reached what would be the normal progression, specifically in the state forest that Representative Neuberger's weighing in, and how that and the effects of the amendment. I'm assuming you've seen the 824 amendment.
Yes, Mr. Chair, I have it. And
you could identify yourself.
I'm sorry, for the record, Bob Meyer, Department of Natural Resources. The issue that you're talking about up in the Sand Dune State Forest is rather complicated, and we've been doing the best we can. We need to do better communicating up there and have some more public meetings. But it's really some red pine plantations we're looking at removing and then doing some reforestation activities. It's also further complicated with trust land issues and some exchanges we're working on in the area. So when you mentioned clear cutting, it's not as if the trees that were planted there to be harvested in this manner. It's a plantation. So unfortunately, these plantations grow into be forests, and people love them, and they become, things that they want to keep, right? So,
well, and Commissioner Meyer, to that point, I personally don't want to micromanage whether DNR forestry in their recommendations decides whether it be clear-cutted or in a rotational basis where you take a third and a third in 15-year increments and it's a 75-year or 100-year rotation, or if it's just a 50-year clear-cut rotation. I understand that. I think Representative Neuberger's concern is in some cases we may be doing it prematurely before the normal rotation would be. And I guess I don't want to speak for Representative Neuberger, but it's probably a good idea to get this amendment on and we further the discussion, because I know there's been some real important meetings taking place right in this area where maybe we could learn more what the locals had to say, and is there a solution where we work together and find an answer. I guess that's where Representative Neuberger, where he's coming from. Again, I don't want to speak for him. I understand DNR's position, but I'm not sure the intent of this amendment was to facilitate premature clear cutting or rotational cutting.
Mr.
Commissioner
Chairman,
Meyer.
I just had the opportunity to speak with Representative Neuberger briefly the other day, and I mentioned that we do need to get a meeting scheduled and discuss this issue and where we're going. We do not support the amendment, but we do support exactly the path you're talking about, is working with Representative Neuberger to try to move this issue forward and come to some kind of resolution. So with that in mind, if there's still the ability to work on this language as it moves forward, we need to have those conversations and get a plan put together, and we're willing to do that.
Yeah, and Commissioner Meyer, Representative Neuberger will certainly make himself available, and I would recommend you work with all of us that we find a solution that works. It is going to Legacy next, and Representative Neuberger will work with you on the issue. Representative Hansen.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I think as long as if the DNR is opposed, but if the parties are willing to work together on the next step, I'm in favor of moving it along.
Okay. All those in favor of the A24 say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. The amendment's adopted. The next amendment is the A15 amendment. Ms. Taylor, I'm going to ask you to walk through the A15 and tell us what the effect of that amendment is. If you could do that, that would be great.
Mr. Chair, members, this amendment may look familiar. This was added to the SARD-SAMHSA Outdoor Heritage Council bill last time. What it would do, if you look on lines 2.21 through 2.22, that's just some getting rid of some obsolete language. The real change would be on lines 2.25 and 2.26 and 2.7. This would clarify that the LCC is the one who would appoint the staff and do the contracts for purposes of administrating the council. So changing sort of the hiring and administrative functions over to the LCC instead of what it says now, which is that upon coordination with, which was, I think there was some need for clarification according to the LCC, so.
Thank you, Ms. Taylor. And I'd like to move the A15 amendment be adopted. Members, this is an amendment that we put on last year, and when we got to conference committee, Senator Cohen asked that we remove that amendment from our bill last year and that we come back this year allowing them to have some discussion and awareness earlier in the process, and that's why we're moving the A15 now, so that the Senate can see what we're talking about and allow them some opportunity to discuss the issue. And that's where that's coming from. Any further, Representative Hansen.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And I think last year I supported your amendment moving out of committee. The conversation continued. We have some members who are not supportive of that. I think there is a difference in how the underlying statutory language is for outdoor heritage compared to LCCMR. We'll probably have that discussion. I think we look at, I think you and I are in agreement that how the process worked when the last hiring was not, shall we say, the best. And but I know there's concern in terms of authority with the role of the council in terms of having input. And I think we may have some folks that have comments on this, but continuing the conversation may be worthwhile.
Well, and thank you, Representative Hansen, and I think I can speak for both of us that our thoughts about the process not working is not a reflection on any of the individuals involved, absolutely. It's about the process and could it be better. Other members, discussion on the A15? Any other members on the A15? Seeing no further discussion, I'm sorry. Representative Uglem.
Mr. Chair, just point of order, is someone moving this amendment?
I did move the amendment. I didn't originally. You're observant, Representative Uglem. Ms. Sipko reminded me I hadn't moved it, so in the middle of discussion, I moved it. And thank you for catching that I didn't originally do that. All those in favor of the A15 say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. The amendment's adopted. Next, members, is the A22 amendment. That's my amendment. I would like to move the A22. And then if Mr. Johnson, if you could allow I'd like the deer hunters to be able to come forward. I'm assuming this is their proposal, members. The deer hunters came up with an innovative solution looking at some of the potlatch land. Most of us realize that today Potlatch is showing an interest in abandoning our state in regards to owning forest land in Minnesota. It does not fit their business model anymore, and so they are rather in large parcels changing their ownership in Minnesota. And the deer hunters have put together a proposal originally, I believe, in the $18, $19 million range, looking at, if I remember right, in the upper teen, 18,000 acres or some amount of acres. Of the Potlatch, I believe it's around 30,000 acres that Potlatch is looking at moving. And the deer hunters, through their leadership, saw an opportunity. Maybe we could play a role in facilitating some of the common sense transfer. I've met with Mr. Englund, and we have looked at the maps. Some of these lands are literally surrounded by tax forfeited land that's currently being managed specifically, I know, in Cass and maybe also in Wadena County is the third one, right?
Cass and, excuse me, Mr. Chair.
If you could identify yourself.
Craig Engwall, Executive Director of Minnesota Deer Hunters Association. Cass County and Hubbard County have land departments that manage hundreds of thousands of acres of land. Wadena County does not have a land department.
Okay, thank you. And so that's the gist of this. It's a new step forward for Deer Hunter Association to play a role in facilitating some of that transfer. And what I was saying was some of this land is literally surrounded by, it could be a whole section of county managed land where it's basically forested, and then there's a 80 or such in the center there that's is owned by Potlatch. My amendment strikes down the LCCMR's recommendation further from $5.5 million to $1.5 million. I believe it allows the Deer Hunter Association to show that they can work in a good way, working with two of our counties that have great land departments and do some good work. The reason for deleting this amount of money in this project is it would bring us to, and I'll let Mr. Hagemeyer, could you state the percentage we'll get to with this amendment in reserve and the millions that would be in reserve?
Mr. Chair, if this amendment was adopted, the dollar amount would be $7,360,000, and that'd be a 7.09% reserve.
And so, members, I think it's important, with what I would say was not a real huge change in the forecast from November to February, we went in the red in our recommendations when we were at about a 3% cushion. This is to still go a little below the middle of what MMB is recommending. 7.5% would be theirs, but this puts us at about 7%. So that is the effect of the amendment. Engwall, if you can give us your testimony, and you already said you represent the Deer Hunters Association, you're their executive director. Thank you for your work, and go ahead with your testimony.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and to no surprise, we do not support the amendment, and I'll speak to what the nature of our project is, which is to protect forest habitat in an area where about 42 square miles of forest land has been converted to non-forest uses. I think it's important to note that before we even applied to Lessard SAMs, we engaged the counties in this effort with the county land commissioners to look at lands, talk about the issue. We met with each county board at least two times. And again, before we applied, we had unanimous resolutions from all three counties supporting the full funding, the $19 million for this project. We worked with them to address any concerns about pilt. That's why this is crafted to have them manage the lands, and then if they can't, or if there's a rare circumstance where a township would prefer that MDHA as a 501c3 hold the land, we could do that and manage the timber and sell it. We worked through those issues with them. We met with supervisors from over 20 township boards. We met with soil and water conservation districts, talked to the mayors in the area about water quality concerns. And that's how we came to this proposal. And subsequent to applying and the recommendation coming out at $5.5 million, we've talked to the land commissioners again. We've winnowed down the parcels we're looking at to about 4,000. We've purposely excluded parcels where county services are provided along county highways, state highways, et cetera, where it makes sense for development to occur. And that's how we ended upon the acreage we're at now. And that still is an ongoing process. And if we are funded, we will continue to work with the counties and the townships to select parcels that make the most sense. I would point out that besides the habitat and water quality benefits, this does benefit the loggers in the area. It benefits the mill in Bemidji. I've talked to Pete Obby a number of times about the fact that they want the wood from this area. They think it's a good project. And then, of course, it benefits the public and the recreational opportunities it provides. These lands currently are typically leased and are not open for public recreation or hunting. So that's the nature of the proposal. We have support from the counties to go to a higher level of funding. The land is available, and that's what we're trying to do.
Thank you, Mr. Engwall. Questions for the testifier, questions to the bill? Representative Johnson.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chair. And I guess I just want to comment on the amendment and actually express my opposition to it. I've mentioned to this committee before that in the mid-70s, my father bought some land on the Crow Wing River, right in the Crow Wing watershed. And he moved there in around 1980 and, you know, lived there for about 20 years before he couldn't maintain himself anymore there. But and we still own the small tree farm. And one of the, you know, so I, as you know, I've been up there a lot, and I've, one of the things I've really changed, probably one of the biggest changes in the kind of the social fabric, but also the landscape, has been Potlatch selling off the land. And before they sell it off, as was noted, they lease it. And when they lease it, they really put pressure on you and they expect you to post it. Prior to that, the Potlatch land was just really considered locally as kind of open land, kind of like state land. There's some state land across the road from my place is a parcel of state land. But the Potlatch land has been sold off and is being sold off. And so the result of that is that local folks who have hunted that Potlatch land for generations have been shut off from it. And it's created a little bit of tension, to be honest with you, and just concern. And so when you say that there's unanimous resolutions from the counties, I'm not surprised at all, because I think they're reflecting their constituencies and the people. You know, we know our neighbors. I know quite a few folks up there. And this has really been a pretty major change. And so I think the idea that what the deer hunters are doing here, I think fits very well with the needs of that local area. I want to also, compliment you for taking into the consideration the managing of the timber. I have a real small tree farm, and the Johnson family doesn't live on this tree farm, but there are a lot of small tree farms in that area, and a lot of small owners besides Potlatch. And, I've expressed in this committee before, I think there is an ongoing challenge with the managed forest up in that neck of the woods. If that mill were to close, we would have a major issue facing this committee and facing the state, because the managed forest really needs to be managed, and it needs to be harvested over that rotation that you were chatting about in Anoka County. And so if this is a way to help protect the logging industry and the timber industry and keep that mill operating. And so I think on those grounds, I think this is a very important step. I think it's an important, appropriately bold step, and I argue against the amendment. Thank you.
Thank you. Representative Purcell.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And I just want to speak against the amendment. And I'd ask for a roll call on this, please.
Okay, thank you. I have Representative Fisher next. Representative Fisher.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm also speaking against the amendment. It's coming from a water quality issue. It's very important, and I'm hearing this from St. Paul Water Regional Water Utility. They're located in my district, and the concerns about the breakup of the forest lands that may be starting to happen up the Upper Mississippi watershed and what that does to eventual water quality. They're concerned about what water quality will be in the Mississippi River in the next 15 to 20 years, and they supply transport to many hundreds of thousands of people in the metropolitan area here, and they're trying to, they were talking to me yesterday saying, what can we do to help protect and ensure that the forest land stays strong up in this area? And I think this is a great way to help, where we get a multiple benefit, is not only taking care of the hunters up in the area, but also a benefit that eventually comes down to the metropolitan area by helping protect our waters. And we've already heard how there's so little money from this fund that helps, you know, helps benefit and comes down to the metropolitan area. This would be one way that gives a little bit of that benefit and a little bit of incentive for us to spread this benefit across the entire state. It's not just that region, but also the metropolitan region in having better water quality in the future.
Yeah. And thank you, Representative Fisher. And Mr. Engwall, I want to remind members that this is a new proposal. It's a new innovative idea, and I think it's important that we give you an opportunity to move forward with it, and that was my intent. And you can certainly come back next year, which many do in Lessard Sam's. Director Johnson mentioned some that are phase seven, that they've been back 7 years in a row and have grown and showing the great leadership. And again, I think you've done a great job of laying it out. The question is fiduciary responsibility, and I believe that lies with the legislature, that we craft a bill that most folks, you'll see Governor Dayton substantially changed his budget, realizing that we don't know exactly what's coming forward. And I think it would be responsible for us to leave in the low mid-range of what MMB recommends. And I think it's great discussion about, is this the right project to reduce, or is there a different one that members would support reducing? I think we'll have that discussion going forward. But I think the 7% is a realistic range to be at. And I just wanted to make that point. Representative Uglum.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I have a quick question for Representative Purcell. Representative Johnson made reference to the mill up there as far as forest management goes and everything else. Now, the Potlatch OSB mill, Oriented Strand Board mill, is closed, isn't it?
Representative Purcell.
Mr. Chair, yes, it is.
Okay.
Representative
Uglum. Thank you, Mr. Chair. So the only Potlatch facility up there is that small lumber mill that's spitting out 2x4s, to my knowledge, correct?
Well, Representative Uglum, I don't know if I would classify it as small spitting out 2x4s. If anybody's got some time, Representative Hancock, you and I had a terrific tour of there 3-4 years ago. You're right, it does spit them out, Representative Uglum, but the rate that it spits them out, and it decides if it's a 2x4, a 2x6, if it's 92 5/8 inches long, or is it an 8-foot, or can it be a 9-foot 2x6? And then the quality and such, the electric eyes, and Representative Purcell, you've been there too. It's in your district, if I'm not mistaken.
So have I, Mr. Chair. I used to sell those guys product, but it's a relatively small mill, but I believe that's the only one that's left from Potlatch up there. Is that correct?
Yeah.
Representative Purcell.
Right.
Okay.
And
okay.
We want it to stay going, and we
certainly do.
Yes. Yeah. Thank you, Representative Uglum. Great point. Representative Eklund.
Thank you, Mr. Chair and members. One part of that, Representative Uglum, as far as the forest management practice aspect of this, a significant amount of the chips go to the Boise Paper Mill in International Falls that are produced from that mill. Several truckloads a day are transported up there, so I just wanted to make that point.
Well, and thank you. I'm not surprised that you're making that point. So that's a good one to be made. Let's see, Representative Hansen.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And we had a little confusion kind of at the beginning, and I just want to clarify. So you as the chair support the project because it's an innovative project that the deer hunters brought forward, but you're bringing forward the amendment to reduce the amount, and the Deer Hunters Association does not support the amendment.
We do not support Correct. The amendment, Mr. Chair, Mr. Representative Hansen.
Correct. Any further discussion? Any testimony for or against this amendment in the audience? Any testimony for or against? Any members to speak for or against the amendment? The clerk will call the roll.
Start with me. Chair McNamara?
Yes.
Representative Fabian?
Aye.
Representative Clark?
No.
Representative Cornish?
Aye.
Representative Eklund?
No.
Representative Fenton?
Aye.
Representative Fisher?
No.
Representative Green?
Aye.
Representative Hackbarth?
Aye.
Representative Hancock?
Aye.
Representative Hansen?
No.
Representative Hausman?
No.
Representative Heintzman?
Aye.
Representative Hornstein?
No.
Representative Johnson?
No.
Representative Neuberger?
Aye.
Representative Purcell?
No.
Representative Poppy?
No.
Representative Rarick?
Aye.
Representative Torkelson?
Aye.
Representative Uglum?
Yes.
There being 12 ayes and 9 nays, the amendment's adopted. Let's see. I think we have a few more. The next amendment is the A-19 amendment. That's my amendment. Members, this would take the project in Clearwater County, and would put it in the ownership of the DNR to be managed under outdoor recreation system under Chapter 86A. That the gist of that is that would allow DNR flexibility to manage it potentially as a wildlife management area, I think state rec area, and or also state forest. This amendment's not coming from the DNR. It does not have, I did not seek their support, so I don't expect they're willing to weigh in on this. If you remember right, last year when we passed this bill out of the House, we did not include this project. It had zero funding. This, coincidentally, happens to be potlatch land again in Clearwater County that is... has it on three sides of it has an existing DNR WMA. I think from a logistics and a common sense standpoint, it makes sense to be DNR owned land and managed land. This will also take care of the issue of not being paid pilt, and with Representative Fabian's bill, but actually even before your amendment, Representative Fabian, and whether it was on the bill or not, DNR would have to go to Clearwater County and get approval for the purchase. And if Clearwater County says no, the only recourse for DNR would be to go to the very rarely used land commission, I believe it's called, and seek their approval for this. So I think this is a huge step forward in allowing the process to work, allowing Clearwater County to be part of the process, have the pilt be paid on the land. And so that's the gist of the amendment. I know I'm that the tribe will want to speak, and I certainly want to allow them and allow anybody else in the audience. There may be some logistic questions for DNR about the management or how it would be, but we have not presented this amendment with their support or asked for their feelings for or against this thing. This is something I think makes sense, and I don't think it's right to put an agency in the middle of a very political situation. So this, I think, is in a very tough situation, is a huge compromise by the House to, in a county that Representative Green, Representative Hancock, legitimately have real reservations about buying more land up there until DNR gets serious about starting to sell land that they should no longer own and put back in private ownership. So. That's the gist of it. Why don't we maybe see if some members want to comment, or I'd like to allow the tribe to come down and speak of where they're coming from. Representative Clark.
Mr. Chairman, I'm just going to ask that if we could hear from the tribe. This is essentially the same amendment that Representative Green offered last time. Is that correct?
Representative Clark, I may have offered the amendment last year to strike the project, or maybe Representative Green did. No. I don't remember. We struck the project, I believe, in this committee in its entirety, and it went all the way to conference, and actually that was the bill that got signed into law. So unfortunately, this beautiful land is jeopardized because it was not included last year. Potlatch has shown an interest in getting out of this state because the economics don't work. And truthfully, economics don't work because trees grow faster in Alabama and Louisiana than they do in Minnesota. So it makes more sense for them to grow pine trees in the southern United States than Minnesota. Sorry, that's the geography that's really the number one thing. Our tax policies hurt too, but the reality is it's more a geography thing. And so you've got to understand where Potlatch is coming from. Why don't I ask the tribal nation to come down. Representative Purcell.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and I would like to speak against the amendment. I'd like to hear White Earth testimony, and then I want to speak again, but I want to ask for a roll call at this time, just so we get
so
that.
Roll call has been requested, and then if the nation could come down, if you could identify yourself for the record, who you represent, and give us your testimony on the amendment. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Chairman and members of the committee. I am Tara Mason. I'm the Secretary Treasurer for the White Earth Reservation. And we are here to speak opposing the amendment. White Earth has been the applicant twice now for this property and really looking at this piece, and for a number of reasons. One is that our understanding is that the DNR doesn't have any interest in managing this property. And White Earth does. We manage 55,000 acres, and this would be no problem to continue the management in this area. The other concern that we have is that that really looking at the ability for White Earth to move forward and manage is a necessity. This is solely within the property of the exterior boundaries of the reservation, and really looking at the resources and where it's located as far as our rice beds and our natural resources in the area. So it's very significant. And I think what we need to really consider is the cultural value and the significance, what this would mean to White Earth. This is prime territory and land, and really looking at the cultural significance is important to us. And I think there was, really looking moving forward as far as the pilt is concerned, and some of those pieces, we're taking those into consideration, and we have a couple different proposals, and we want to move forward with that. But I also have Lorena Volt with me, who is our land acquisition specialist, so if we have any questions, we'd be more than happy to answer them. Thank you.
Why don't you identify yourself and give us your additional testimony?
Good morning, Mr. Chairman and committee members. My name is Lorena Vogt. I'm the land acquisition specialist for White Earth Natural Resources. I want to thank the Lasard Sam's Council, first and foremost. 2 years in a row, this project has been fully vetted and approved for full funding. As we can all admit, it's a gorgeous piece of property that needs protection, and we have 30 natural resource staff on hand waiting to implement conservation projects on the land in cooperation with the DNR. Yesterday, I was at a meeting actually with Greg Nelson. He's the regional director of the DNR in our area. It was actually a day-long meeting, and the whole day there was no inclination that they wanted to take over this project. What we did talk about was our cooperative projects. We discussed prescribed burning, workforce development, outreach, education, enforcement issues. We worked together on all these things. The land would be open to the public. Yes, White Earth would own it, but due to the fact that it would be open to the public, we would work in cooperation with the DNR in the region, as we do now, to manage the property. And we continue to work well together. We are strengthening our government-to-government relationships. And to strip this project from the bill would be detrimental to all the progress we've had with our relationships and building our working relationships and working together to manage the conservation projects in this region. So.
Thank you for your testimony. Representative Purcell.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I know we had a lot of discussion on this, I think mostly on the floor last year, and I just want to reiterate my, I got to think of the right word here, I can't say bull hockey, my something short of disgust, because I think there's a, I believe there are folks that have, both sides have honorable intentions, I really believe that. However, I think that the history's lost, and all of that White Earth Res was White Earth land back in the day when the treaties were signed. And there's reacquisition policies on every, for every tribe that I know in Minnesota's got a reacquisition policy to get their land back. And some of that land was taken illegally. I think some of you know the history, some of you don't. There's settlements that are ongoing, court cases that are ongoing on that at the federal level. So I think this is a small piece of trying to restore some property within a very important watershed, a multi-million dollar rice bed watershed that can be protected. And I just really believe we should move forward in a good way, and my sense of the Indian country I represent, this is not in a good way. So leave it at that, and then we've got a roll call, I know, so thank you.
Thank you. Further discussion from members? Further discussion? Anyone in the audience want to speak for or against the amendment? Representative Hansen.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I would like to get DNR on the record.
Okay. Commissioner Meyer, you want to come down and reiterate that this amendment is not yours, unless you were working behind my back to do it. It was my amendment drafted by me solely. It's been something I've offered for a long time as a solution, I think. And if you want to comment on where you're at on the amendment.
Sure, Mr. Chairman, members of the record, Bob Meyer, Assistant Commissioner, DNR. We haven't had any conversations about actually owning this land. We do consider it a high priority land to be protected and are appreciative of the White Earth Band efforts to do so. If it's the desire of the legislature for things to happen differently, we will work with the band and the legislature to do whatever we can to make sure that land is protected. We do take our tribal consultation very seriously in working with the bands and making sure we have the best relationships we possibly can. So with that, we can work through the language with your amendment if it passes. We do have concerns about the existing language in the bill that the council put on that would require management of the land as it would meet tribal season. So this would take care of that issue, I believe. So we do have concerns about how we would actually even implement that or enforce the existing language that's in the bill about the harvesting seasons.
Well, thank you, Commissioner Meyer, and sorry that I didn't mention it, but my clarifying language removes something that Lassard Sams put on. Just so all the folks know, there were not 9 votes to pass the Lassard Sams bill out of Lassard Sams. It fell short of the required 9 vote majority until I believe it was Representative or Member Shara offered an amendment, and it might not have been his amendment, but somebody offered an amendment that would require seasons to be managed differently, and the reality was it was unmanageable. DNR doesn't set the waterfall seasons, and that was, I think, unfortunately, Representative Purcell, to your point, I believe it was attack on the Native Americans' ability to have different hunting seasons than those that are not Native American. And I support that. I think that's the reality. As a matter of fact, it's been a U.S. Supreme Court or a Supreme Court ruling that supports that, and we do that. They do it in a great way. They manage it. Their seasons are different, and that is right. And I think Sam's Outdoor Heritage Council made a serious mistake when they went after that arrangement. And as you mentioned, Commissioner Meyer, it wouldn't even be legal and unmanageable. But it got the ninth vote to get that bill out of there for the first time ever. I believe it only passed with 9 votes, unfortunately, and most of it centers around this project. Additional discussion, Representative Hornstein.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And I just wanted to clarify, so the DNR is neutral on this amendment. You neither oppose it or support it.
Mr. Chairman.
Commissioner Meyer.
Whatever it takes to have this land protected is our best interest. So if the legislature would allow White Earth to acquire the land, we would support that. If the legislature decides that the land should be managed by the DNR, we would implement that. We're an implementing agency, right? We would work with the band to make sure that whatever we want to do jointly, we can do jointly. We can also designate units and subunits within so we could make it a wildlife management area and a state forest and things like that. So that's what this language represents there. So,
well, thank you, Mr. Chair.
Representative Hornstein.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Well, with that clarification, I mean, it's very important that we have this perspective that it be protected. And I, you know, who best to protect it than the band, than the indigenous people that are familiar with this area, that are historically justified in controlling that land. I thought Representative Purcell's point was very well taken about history. And so I think we should oppose this and allow the White Earth folks to protect this land. Who better to protect it than those that have such a strong vested interest in historical precedent for doing so?
Thank you. Representative Hansen.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And I want to focus on your last 3 lines of the amendment. And if I could get the White Earth Nation to comment on what you referenced as the compromise language, and maybe they did, but whether that portion of the hunting zone compromise, whether that, and I'd like DNR to circle back too, because I think you've got 2 parts here, Mr. Chair, and I want to know what if that second part is even workable as it was drafted.
And Representative Hansen, I think so we can clarify, why don't we have Ms. Taylor, I think it might make sense. I'm wondering if she shouldn't read. It's not very long. Ms. Taylor, why don't you read, and people listen as Ms. Taylor reads what was passed and what's in the bill currently. And then it would be appropriate for both the nation and DNR, I think, has already spoke that they were opposed. But if I'm not mistaken, they're opposed to the language that we're talking about, not opposed to the amendment that we're offering. They supported the original proposal, and they're not weighing in on the amendment, but they are opposed to part of the amendment in the language fix that's included in the amendment. Ms. Taylor, if you can read what Representative Hansen is talking about in the last 3 lines of my amendment, and maybe you can direct people to where you're at.
Mr. Chair, members, I'm on page 12. It starts on line 15 and runs through line 21. And it reads, the White Earth Nation and the Commissioner of Natural Resources shall create a special single hunting zone on property acquired with this appropriation that is based on the White Earth Nation's tribal hunting, fishing, trapping, and gathering seasons and limits.
So the gist of this is, members, that if we were to adopt the hunting season that the White Earth Nation has, they would significantly lengthen the hunting seasons on this land for everyone, and it would create a unique little zone of 2,000 acres. And if you want to speak to what would be required or how you could implement it if you were managing the land.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. One, we do oppose this language. We have spoken with the commissioner of the DNR, and we've had some conversation. What we're really looking at is we're looking at conservation. We're looking at land management, resource management. We do have seasons, both hunting and fishing, that are longer and extended than the state's, but we manage our resources on those lands. If we open this up to the entire population, you know, we're jeopardizing some of our very important resources on just this 2,000 land, and I think it would make it very difficult. So White Earth is in opposition to 12.15 down to 12.21. So we don't think that this is something that is really feasible or able to manage, being able to have this unique season. This was something that we expected to have some discussion on and really look at being able to state our position on this. And then we had the additional amendment striking White Earth altogether. So that's where we sit and stand. So thank you.
Okay. Well, thank you. And why don't we, members, why don't I retract my amendment first? And I'm going to let Representative Hansen, why don't you just move to divide it? You know, Representative Hansen, I'm not sure that why don't we just vote on the amendment? If you don't want to support the amendment, don't support the amendment. That's the simple gist of it. That's what I would recommend at this point. We already know the testimony. No one supports the language. It's not even workable. We've all said that. The tribe has said it. The DNR has said it. I said it at Lessard Sam's. It's a joke. The DNR doesn't manage waterfall. It's managed by the U.S. Fish and Wildlife. They couldn't weigh in on it anyway. So the clerk will call the roll. McNamara votes aye.
Fabian.
Aye.
Clark.
No.
Cornish.
Aye.
Eklund.
Aye.
Fenton.
Aye.
Fisher.
No.
Green.
No.
Hackbarth.
Aye.
Hancock.
Aye.
Hansen.
No.
Hausman.
No.
Heintzman.
Aye.
Hornstein.
No.
Johnson.
No.
Neuberger.
Aye.
Purcell.
No.
Poppy.
No.
Rarick.
Aye.
Torkelson?
Aye.
Uglem?
Yes.
There being 12 ayes and 9 nays, the amendment's adopted. Members, we have a couple more. The A26, Representative Hansen.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and just like a couple of your amendments, I have I'd passed this out of this committee last year. It is saying that land acquired in fee with money appropriated in this section, so it's this bill, not previous bills or any future bills, but these shall not be planted or otherwise treated with a product that contains a pollinator lethal insecticide, and that is one that it's on the label that it kills bees and other pollinators. So it is an enforceable choice that the land managers could make on choosing not to use a pollinator lethal insecticide. So I'd move the A26 amendment and encourage its support. I think I got a copy of the Constitution here, and it says that funds deposited in the Outdoor Heritage Fund may be spent only to restore, protect, and enhance wetlands, prairies, forests, and habitat for fish, game, and wildlife. And when we're talking about these funds, we often talk about fish and game and don't talk about wildlife. And the wildlife can be things that are not, that you don't hunt or fish for. can be the small wildlife, the little things, and we need to pay attention to the little things, the things that are at the beginning of the food chain, because then the things that are we hunt may not be there if they don't have anything to eat. So I think this is a reasonable step. It's on the use of public funds. I think it would help meet the constitutional requirements to protect wildlife. And it's a small step that can be done to protect pollinators with our public resource.
See no more discussion. Oh, I'm sorry. Representative Torkelson.
Oh, thank you, Mr. Chair. I'd just like to speak against this amendment. While we certainly do have an issue with pollinators, including bees, this is not an appropriate response. There's no scientific proof that this will benefit them in any way, and these are very useful tools for agriculture.
Representative Hansen.
Mr. Chair, I would encourage members to look at a Washington Post article just this morning where they're proposing that two native bumblebees in the United States be added to the endangered species list. So there's a hard regulatory option of in the endangered species protection that may be coming versus taking the approach of trying to protect pollinators on our own public land that we acquire with the legacy dollars. I would ask for a roll call, Mr. Chair.
Okay. Representative Heinzman.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Representative Hansen, I'm wondering if you might be open to adding an amendment that would allow some time for those managing those properties, because there's been some difficulty beginning a new process and then phasing in the reduction or the elimination of chemicals and then also the seeds and plants that we're concerned about.
Representative Hansen.
Mr. Chair, I think I want to be clear, and Representative Heinzman, I appreciate that effort. We're not saying that this would be organic. We're not saying that we're banning every use. It's making choices, and there are choices when that acquisition occurs and as it's transferred into native vegetation. There are alternatives to the pollinator lethal insecticides. So, you know, I'd like to proceed with what we have. You know, I'd be happy to talk with you in the future on this, because I think there may be some things there and maybe looking at clarifying, because we're referencing a section that references pollinator lethal insecticides, of which there is a definition of. And so when we look at the label on an insecticide, there are those that will say caution and those that will say that they impact pollinators. And that's what I'm looking at there, not all pesticides.
Thank you. Seeing no further discussion, the clerk will call the roll. McNamara votes no.
Fabian.
No.
Clark.
Yes.
Cornish.
No.
Eklund.
Yes.
Fenton.
No.
Fisher.
Yes.
Green.
No.
Hackbarth.
No.
Hancock.
No.
Hansen.
Yes.
Hausman?
Yes.
Heinzman?
No.
Kornstein?
Yes.
Johnson?
Aye.
Neuberger?
No.
Purcell?
Aye.
Poppy?
No.
Rarick?
No.
I'm sorry, Representative Poppy, could you repeat yours one more time for me?
No.
Okay. Torkelson?
No.
Uglum?
Yes.
There being 9 ayes and 12 nays, the amendment fails. Next, I think this is the last amendment we have. Representative Hansen.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And this amendment, I'd move the A27 amendment.
Representative Hansen moves the A27. Go ahead, Representative Hansen, explain your amendment.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And this is referencing what I talked about earlier. What if this whole bill, $115 million, only allocated a single-digit percent to Greater Minnesota? What would be the response? Several years ago, we tried, I think, in a bipartisan way to have balance, or at least some attempt at having some opportunity in the seven-county metro area and in Greater Minnesota for urban communities of greater than 50,000 people to be eligible for the small grant program. And that was a discussion about having some equal opportunity because the small grant program was very popular. What the bill does is, if you look at the total amount, $7.438 million that is to the small grant programs, and of that, only $2.5 million would go to urban areas, the seven county metro, and urban areas in Greater Minnesota, greater than 50,000 in population. Representative Johnson, I think that was your amendment previously to have urban areas and rural in Greater Minnesota to be able to be eligible. And I know the question came up about, well, you know, they aren't applying or there's not enough demand. And I think there is demand. However, because of the interpretation that all land must be open to hunting and fishing. Now, I expect we'll probably get the camel's nose under the tent argument that we usually do. And I have no intent of using that question on any type of hunting discussion. I think, Mr. Chair, you know that I hunt and have my whole life. But I don't think it's fair that the earmark, which is what it is, of out of $115 million at 2.5 million is available for the seven county metro area small grants and urban communities greater than 50,000 throughout Greater Minnesota. I would hope that we could move this forward to have that discussion continue, because I think it did start, and Mr. Johnson referenced that the council was talking about it. But if we appropriate money, another year goes by with that inequity, and all we're asking for is adding $1.2 million so that there's equity for urban communities wherever they are in the state.
Thank you. Representative Hansen, the one thing I would say, just so members realize, that the Metropolitan CPL program had to go to a second round. It did not have enough grant applications in the first round. That was not true in the statewide. The statewide had many more applications than were it was able to fund. The Metro did fund them in the second round. When they went through the second round, they were able to fund them. And so that's the gist of it. Seeing no more discussion, all those in favor of the A27 say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Those opposed say nay. Nay.
Aye.
The amendment's not adopted. Members, we have the bill before us. Any further discussion to the bill? All those in favor of the House File 2611 being passed and moved on to the Legacy Committee say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed nay.
No.
The amendment moves to the Legacy Funding Finance Committee. Representative Fabian. No? You're just whispering. Mr. Power, why don't you come down and say hello? My friends from my favorite industry before, we did approve the minutes, Representative Hackbar. Thank you for asking. I see you came in. It's your day on the Hill. Tell us who you are and what you got going on today.
Thank you, Mr. Chair.
My name is Tim Power. I'm the Legislative Affairs Manager for the Minnesota Nursery and Landscape Association, and we have about 40 industry members lobbying on three separate issues today, one of which is Representative Hansen's bill, the Emerald Ash Borer Suppression Program. We have been...
That I'm a co-author of. Right?
Of which the chair is a co-author,
yeah,
correct.
Yeah, thank you.
This bill is important to us because the issue is very important to our industry, but more importantly to our state. We went from 6 to 12 counties infested in 2015. We expect more this year, and we think that this is going to come down hard on Minnesota's communities.
Both what are your other two issues? We never get to get done early, so you're standing between me adjourning this thing. So can you tell me your two other issues?
The other two issues involve retainage for subcontractors, and we're working with the Minnesota Subcontractors Association on putting some limits on retainage on construction projects. And the third issue has to do with uniform state labor standards.
Okay. Well, thank you, Mr. Power. Thank you for coming forward. We appreciate, and I hope you and everyone in the industry has a great day. It looks like the industry may get an early start, though that might not be true up on the North Shore. Thank you, Mr. Power. Representative Clark.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I just wanted to clarify. Did you say, are you with the forestry products as well?
I'm sorry.
Are you with the forestry products as well as landscaping?
Forestry products certainly will be affected by the emerald ash borer because some mm-hmm. of the raw materials, that is ash, is currently under quarantine and has to stay within quarantine areas.
He doesn't represent him, though, Representative Clark.
Okay, Mr. Chairman. I'm very interested in if we're going to have forestry products people testifying at some point.
I think we will.
Okay, because I yes. want to...
About the wood chips and crumb rubber.
Yes, about wonderfully locally produced alternatives to crumb rubber that our forestry products can provide so that we'll have safer playing fields for our youth.
And what Representative Clark is talking about is the use of crumb rubber in playgrounds, play areas, as opposed to the natural wood chips, which are an alternative that are arguably... more friendly to kids playing on it. Representative Clark.
Mr. Chairman, it's actually as opposed to rubber tires that have been ground up in our petroleum product that leave us with toxic exposures.
Yes, thank you. See, no further discussion. We're adjourned, members.